Conference organizers for inviting me, and I want to thank Publishers Communications Group, who did the research that I'm reporting on, for inviting me to come and share the results with you. My name is Deborah Linares. As Tim said, I have a lot of work to do at Wellesley College. I'm manager of acquisitions, serials, and resource sharing. I'm also the science collections management librarian, so I do selecting for books and journals in the sciences. My partner in this presentation is Emily Delke, who's here in the front row. And Emily is from Publishers Communications Group, and she's the head of research, and she ran the research study. So what I'll be talking about today, first we'll do a little overview about the two organizations. I'll explain what patron-driven acquisition means, at least during this presentation. Go over the survey and the methodology, and then do some look at the results, and I'll also give my own reflections about our experience at Wellesley College and whether the results of the survey make sense or not based on our experience. So first, many of you are probably familiar with Wellesley College. I've been there for 2 years, and I have a previous background in a corporate library and a public academic library as well. So Wellesley College is a small liberal arts women's college. It's about 14 miles west of Cambridge in Wellesley, Mass. It's highly selective. It's undergraduate only. We do not have any master's or PhD programs. But there is a very strong emphasis across all the disciplines on student research. We're actually, I would say, maybe a little bit flipped from most of the research universities, where our faculty are very focused on the teaching aspects and really focused on being good, delivering the teaching, and good with their relationships with the undergraduates. But the students are really focused on doing a lot of research, and particularly in the sciences. And there's a lot of student experience hands-on in the research. It's a very small school, about 2,000 students and 350 faculty. And I've shared here our collections budget information. So this is what the library spends on journals and databases, $1.5 million just about on journals and databases combined. And then on our monographs collection budget, we're spending about $600,000. So this is actually FY10 information. FY11 is a little bit less, as you've heard. And about Publishers Communications Group, it's an organization based, it's a consulting group. It's based here in Cambridge, Massachusetts, also in Oxford in the United Kingdom, and a location in Rio de Janeiro in Brazil. There's an international staff of 25, and all of their staff either have a publishing or a library experience. Emily herself has been with Publishers Communications Group for 5 years, and she has a library background. They offer sales, marketing, and research services for scholarly publishers, and to do that, they work with over 30,000 libraries and consortia around the world. So what I'm speaking about today is patron-driven acquisition. I'm only speaking about ebooks. Within the library community, patron-driven acquisition can sometimes be talked about with different kinds of acquisition. Sometimes people are thinking about print books. Sometimes people are thinking about, if a patron sends me an email saying, hey, can I have this book, that might be a patron-driven acquisition. But what I'm talking about today is only ebooks. It would mean, thus, it would be immediate access to the content. And generally, the books are found through the library catalog. At least that's what librarians think. And they're paid through some institutional deposit account. We pay up front, and then the costs are generally deducted as we go along. And generally, the end user is not aware of whether the book is an owned book or it's just a book that's sitting waiting to be purchased. So let me explain a little bit about what the end user experience is for that, in case you're not familiar. So if I'm a student and I'm doing research, I might search in the catalog, the library's catalog. I might search on Google. I might search in one of the library databases. So if I'm searching in the catalog, I would find, you know, if I'm doing research on global warming, I might find 50 books that the library has. Some are print books in the stacks. I, of course, am in my pajamas in my dorm room doing my research, so there are print books that are in the stacks in one of the libraries, And then there are ebooks, either books that we ebooks that we own, or these ebooks that we've loaded into our catalog through the patron-driven acquisition. So at Wellesley College, we've loaded in about 50,000 titles, in ebook titles, into our catalog that we don't own, but that have immediate access. So if I'm a student and I see one of these titles, I don't know whether it's owned or not. I don't know if it's part of a package the library has already paid for, or if it's a patron-driven access collection. I click on the book, I have access to what I need immediately. If the library systems are all set up correctly, it would also work then if I did a, if the student does a search in a library database or Google, they should be able to be passed through the catalog into the book as well. In the article world, this is generally called pay-per-view access, but I'm talking only about ebooks today. So this is a chart of print book circulation data. This is actually data taken from Brown University, but this is pretty standard and this has been reported on many times in the literature. So in this graph you can see that 40% of the books that libraries buy, either through approval plans or for firm orders, have never been checked out. So this is with, after a book has been in the collection for 4 years, we see that 40% of those books have never been checked out. And an additional 26% have only been checked out one time. So a big majority of the books are never used or only used once. So as I said, my previous experience was with a corporate library, and this is especially in a corporate library really not acceptable to be spending on money on materials that are never used. And the academic libraries are coming, especially now with the budget problems that we're all facing, coming more and more to see that this is really an unacceptable use rate. So this is print circulation data. This is what we've been doing. This is with, you know, collections managers who take pride in thinking that they know exactly what our users need and we're buying for them what they need, or the approval plans that we have set up designed to collect what we need. And we're not doing a very good job. So the survey that I'm reporting on. Publishers Communications Group contacted about 250 libraries. Those libraries were targeted as libraries that collected ebooks. So there was some way that they identified that there were ebooks in the collection. Of the 250 libraries that they contacted, there 74 interviews were conducted, because they interviewed only librarians that either already had a patron-driven acquisition program in place, or libraries that were ready to deploy a program within the next year. So these were very knowledgeable librarians about patron-driven acquisition. They'd already made decisions about what was important to them and what they were expecting to see. The other thing to note is that these librarians really wanted to talk about this. They were generally on the phone for about 20 or 30 minutes. They were really interested in having a conversation about this. There were an additional 90 institutions that had plans to implement patron-driven acquisition in the next 3 years. So you can really see there's a tremendous growth in this area. And just in the conferences I've attended in the past 6 months, this is a very hot topic. A lot of people are talking about it and presenting on it. The survey consisted of 11 questions. There were multiple choice and open-ended questions. The types of institutions that were included were primarily very large research universities, but then also included a few other types of colleges and smaller colleges. So of the 74 institutions that were interviewed, 47% of those had only implemented the program within the past 6 months. So the great majority, you know, the majority of them, this was something that was very new. And then an additional 12% had implemented the program only in the past 12 months. So this is something that's really growing, something that's very new, and something that these libraries don't have a lot of experience with. A lot of the libraries are doing it as a pilot program at this point, where they're spending a very small percent of the collections budget at this point. And I can say that at Wellesley College, we the first year, we spent 2% of our Monographs Collections budget to pay for the patron-driven acquisition program, and that of that, that money came from the Science Collections budget because I fully supported the idea of the patron-driven acquisition, so I agreed to fund it out of the collections budgets that I managed. And then going forward, we'll probably spend more like 10% of our collections budget, and that would be coming from all of the disciplines. So we asked librarians how satisfied they are with the selection process, and nobody said that they were not satisfied. So 50% said they were very satisfied, an additional 38% said that they were satisfied. So you have to remember these are libraries with very little experience or libraries that are starting out to do this, but they're very satisfied with the idea of this at this point. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the advantages and disadvantages, but it's very important as we go through these to remember that these libraries, that these advantages and disadvantages are more based on the expectations of what these programs will deliver, and they're not actually based on the real experiences because few of these libraries have any kind of extended experience with the programs. But of course, the most important advantage that was discussed was that this would increase the return on the investment of the collections. That, as you can see, that of course, that we would only be paying for what is used. Let me back up just a little bit, and I'll explain to you how the program works at Wellesley College. And I'll tell you, we're using the aggregator ebook library. So what we've done with eBook Library is we've imported these 40,000 or 50,000 records into our catalog. We haven't paid for any of them, but we've set it up so that the first, all books have a free browse period. So if a student or a faculty is only looking at the material, not trying to print or copy any of the material, but if they're just looking at the book, and they can look at it for free for 5 minutes. So we have no cost at all for the first 5 minutes that the patron is viewing the book. And then the first two times that the book is used, we pay a small fee. So we pay about 10% or 15% of the list price of the book. We have chosen to set the number of times that's called a short-term loan. We've chosen to have two short-term loans, and then at the third time the book is used, we have chosen to purchase the book, and that is generally at the list price of the book. And then once the book is purchased, we don't have any additional charges for the use of the book. The book sort of they like to say the book sort of falls apart after 370 uses, and then the library would then have the opportunity to buy another copy of the book. So the advantages of this program is that we would only be paying for the books that are used. This increases the return on the investment of the collection. It provides immediate access to resources. I think most libraries are thinking about that immediate access as compared to the way libraries work now. Patrons always have the ability to send in a request, could you please buy this book for me? I need it as a rush. You know, then we'll have it for them in a week or so. But now they would be able to, in the same way, just have access to things immediately. It provides access to much broader collections. It helps libraries to build collections in new areas. And the other really important thing that we've seen is that it helps us to build collections in areas we didn't know were necessary. And at Wellesley, I know that one of the things that I've seen in the sciences is that we're accessing more advanced content than I would normally purchase. So that's been an interesting thing. So it helps the libraries to see what users actually want, and that I would have to qualify by saying what might be a gap in our collection. So it helps us to see what they really want, but they may be accessing the patron-driven acquisition books where we might have a gap in our collection. The other two that were noted in the study were that the patron-driven acquisition would save staff time and reduce costs. In our experience, and we have almost a year's experience with our patron-driven acquisition collection. In our experience, we're not saving staff time, and that was not the purpose of this. The staff time is just shifted to something different. So instead of placing orders for books or doing, we're managing the e-books instead. And for myself, as a selector, it's certainly not saving me staff time, because generally what I'll do when I'm selecting materials is I'll actually check to see if the book is available in the patron-driven collection, and if it is, I don't place an order for it. I just let it ride in the collection and see if it gets used or not. So, in fact, as a selector, I'm probably spending more time because I'm checking in more places to see where it's available. And I don't think that it will necessarily reduce costs. I think that it will shift costs from firm orders or approval plans to patron-driven acquisition. I think it will increase the value of the collection because it would only be things that people are actually using, but I don't think it's actually going to reduce library costs in the long run. That was certainly not our goal in implementing the program. So the next slide is the disadvantages. And I've added here my little commentary that I think most of these are more fears based on the of these libraries who are entering into the program, but not really, they don't have a lot of experience with it. So these are sort of the fears that libraries have about what these programs could do to their collections and their staff. The first is the inability to control cost. This can happen. I think libraries and the book aggregators need to find ways to put controls in. And so what we've done at Wellesley, there are some book aggregators that allow the librarians to kind of intercede, like somebody tries to access a book and then the library has to okay it, and then the patron gets access to it, and we are not interested in doing that at all. But what we've done is, the first most important thing to control costs, in my opinion, is that there needs to be a free browse period. And what it seems to me that those book aggregators that are not allowing free browse periods, the costs just are out of control, and then the libraries can't really, it becomes too difficult for the libraries to manage their costs. And when I show you our actual use and cost data, you'll see some of the reasons for that. I think the free browse period is the most important part. There's a lot of fear among the libraries that this will change the collections in ways that they don't like. They fear that the books that are patron-driven purchased will be more popular, non-scholarly. They'll be more outside of the core of the collection and the core of the curriculum, and it may create very unbalanced collections. There were some fears that small groups of users would find this way to do this out, and then they'd buy a whole bunch of stuff in a certain area. I don't think that our users would spend their time that way, and I think it would be really difficult for them to actually do that. So what we've found is, what we've done to control some of that is that at Wellesley we've set up a profile with content that we know would be appropriate to the collection. We don't go title by title because there are 50,000 titles, but we've selected publishers that we trust. We have taken out certain content sets based on a keyword, like For Dummies. We've taken Cliff's Notes. We've taken some of those things out of the profile so that we can kind of control the kinds of things that may possibly come in. There is a problem that there are not enough scholarly titles available. We really wish all of the university presses would get on board and provide their titles through these aggregator services, and that would make them much more valuable to us. There are concerns about DRM restrictions and the loss of interlibrary loan, and I'll talk about that a little bit later. There's a lot of fear, of course, about the librarian's loss of control. There's some concerns about the amount of staff time it will take to maintain this. They say that some patrons don't want ebooks. This is particularly noted in the humanities, where an entire book needs to be read cover to cover generally. We are actually seeing a lot of humanities titles being used. So I don't know that that's necessarily the case. And we at Wellesley are planning to put in a program to provide handheld reading devices so that our ebook collections can be read cover to cover. So that if we have an ebook in our collection and it's something that should be read in a narrative cover to cover format, we would be able to provide the students with the technology they need to do that. And there's a concern about printing limitations. And I would say also there's a concern from the librarian's point that we don't really want the patrons printing out entire books at our printing stations in the reference room, which they'll do. So here's the use data. Now, you have to remember this: we're a small college, right? And we are using ebook library, so this allows us a free browse period, and it allowed us to create a profile with the kind of content that we wanted to include. So what we've spent so far, and this is 7 months of data, is about $13,000. And when I look at all of the titles that were accessed, either as short-term loans or auto purchases or the firm orders. So I'm excluding in this estimate of value, I'm excluding the browsed books, because we're assuming they just kind of looked at them and they put them back on the shelf. They didn't really use them. So when I look at the titles that were accessed for any length, that's a $52,000 value, and we've spent about $13,000 on that. So in the 7 months, we've had almost 1,000 titles browsed. Of those browsed titles, and generally each of the loans or purchases start out as a browse. So you can look at these sequentially then, generally. So things went from, there were about 1,000 browsed ebooks, and about 59% of those turned into short-term loans that somebody either needed to print something or download it or copy something out of the book, or that they were using it for more than 5 minutes. So about 59%, and this has been consistent as I've looked over the months at the data, about 59% have turned into short-term loans. And of those short-term loans, 34, about 4%, have turned into auto purchases. So 4% of those short-term, 4% of the browsed books were used more than 2 times. They were used 3 times. And that has also been very consistent, and that's that 4% is a number that eBook Library has seen as well with their broad customer base. About 4% of the books that were browsed turn into purchases. And then we've ordered 15 books. These were eBooks that we knew were going to be used in courses, and they were generally the more expensive titles, so to eliminate some of the short-term loan costs, we just firm ordered the book and made it available. And we've seen very nice distribution throughout the disciplines, 40% from the 39% from the sciences, 37% from social sciences, 23% from arts and humanities. And we will be, most likely will be basing our funding of the program based on these disciplines. So in the first year, we took money from the science collections budget to pay for this project. And then next year, it'll be more distributed across the disciplines. If you can't read this slide, don't worry about it. These are just some titles. This is my proof slide. So these are just some titles of the books that were auto-purchased. So this is just proof that the students in our situation are using and purchasing very appropriate titles. Now, of course, we've set our profile to only include the publishers that we trust, and we've tried to exclude inappropriate titles. However, we did have a book about knitting projects for Harry Potter fans, and it's gotten quite a bit of use. Okay. So these were some of the criteria that some of the libraries indicated were important to them in selecting a patron-driven acquisition vendor. And you probably can't read this, but let me just go through this. And they are ranked in order of the criteria that were either very important or important. So the most important criteria was the ability to provide MARC records. I'll just comment on these as we go along. In our situation, we have a separate MARC record provider, so it was important that the aggregator that we were using worked with our MARC record provider, which is called Serial Solutions. So it wasn't so necessary that the aggregator provide us with MARC records. We actually chose to use our MARC record service through Serial Solutions because they provided us with better MARC records and with a more integrated system so that we could download all the MARC records in a way that's easier for us. Integration with local systems, this includes the ILS system and includes the other library systems, link resolvers, et cetera. And then that proprietary ebook software were not needed, that free browsing was allowed, that there were good rights for printing and copying and other DRM, that the amount of embargoed content, what libraries really want is that they want the, if a book comes out in print, they want the ebook to come out at the same time. We'll talk about that a little bit later, hopefully I'll have time. Unlimited simultaneous, these were a few less important features. Unlimited simultaneous users, number of clicks. For Wellesley College, the criteria that were important for us when we chose eBook Library was that free browsing needed to be available in order to help us control our costs. It needed to be integrated with our book vendor. We use YBP, we use the Gobi system. We wanted to be sure to be able to see when a book, if I was ordering a book, and if I had the option to order a book in print, I wanted to easily see was it available through eBook Library, and if I wanted to instead purchase it as a firm order through eBook Library, I would have the ability to do that. So that was an important criteria for us. The publishers that were included was very important, that they be high quality publishers. The interface had to be easy to use, and the per title cost should be comparable to the print. Not 1.5, not 2 times the cost of the print, but the same as the list price for the print, which in fact for us was actually an increase because we generally will buy the paperback. And so what we're paying instead is the hardcover cost. So it was really important to us that it was not 2 times the cost of the print book, but the same cost as the list. The other thing that was important to me was that there would be a format available, that these could be available for downloading onto a handheld reading device, and that the EPUB format be used because that's the standard format right now for ebooks, and it's important that be adopted by the publishers. So, I'm not sure how much more time I have. It's okay. Okay, so some of the issues that are still outstanding to be resolved or issues that libraries are thinking about, that where does patron-driven acquisition fit within a holistic collections management? For a small college like ours, we can do a lot for patron-driven acquisition because our costs can be fairly well contained because our few number of users. For larger universities, they may want to think about licensing as much of the ebook content as they can, or licensing the heavily used ebook content and providing patron-driven acquisition as just one part of the overall collection management. So I think for each of the libraries, it's going to be very different where this fits in, that still has to be thought through and resolved. Libraries are very interested in using patron-driven acquisition either integrated with their approval plans, or eventually we would really like to see it as a replacement of our approval plans. What's needed for this to happen would be that more scholarly publishers need to be involved, either have their own patron-driven acquisition programs or to be involved with the aggregators. And that the electronic and the print needs to come out at the same time. And this is a problem we're really, really frustrated with because we would rather have the ebooks. We feel at Wellesley that our patrons, our students, would rather have the ebooks in most cases unless it's a whole narrative. And we're really frustrated at not being able to be able to make that choice when the book comes out to get the ebook instead of the print. So that we really want from you. Please make the ebooks come out at the same time as the print. When thinking about the possible replacement of the approval plan, we'll talk a little bit later. It's important for you. It's important for publishers to see this as an additional marketing, an additional revenue stream. It's not really. We don't expect to be buying fewer books from you. We expect to be buying different books from you based on what our users want. Interlibrary loan is still important, and I want to, for interlibrary loan, it's important to think of interlibrary loan as this is not a way for libraries to avoid paying for a book. And I don't know if that's generally the impression of publishers, I don't know. But it's important to think of it as libraries, even with patron acquisition, can't be perfect in knowing ahead of time what our patrons need. And so interlibrary loan is a way for us to get really fast, faster than the acquisitions process. It's faster for us to borrow the book from another library. And so interlibrary loan is really important in being able to fill the gaps that we've created because we haven't been able to perfectly select what our patrons will need in the future. It'll be important for ebooks because even though the ebooks might be available for now, we're thinking 5 or 10 years down the road. If we haven't purchased this ebook, we want to be able to borrow it from our friends who have. A lot of the comments from the survey interviews were people mentioned consortial arrangements. There's a big consortial arrangements for patron-driven acquisition happening right now in New York. I'm not very familiar with it. So that was mentioned quite a bit. I have to say we at Wellesley have tried to think about what would be the benefits to us in using a consortial arrangement for a patron-driven acquisition, and we haven't quite figured that out yet. What would be the benefits to Wellesley in doing this as a consortium? But the library culture is very strongly focused on consortial arrangements, and so there's a lot of libraries who are very committed to their consortia, and if they can't share these books within their consortia, they're feeling very inhibited in being able to provide these programs. So that's really something that still has to be worked out within the libraries and within the aggregators and the publishers as well. And then my plug always is to make sure that the content that you're making available or that the aggregators you're working with are making the content available on handheld devices. Our students are using iPhones. They'll probably be using iPads. And there are other reading devices that we really, in order to preserve the value of the collection, the value of the book as a whole, it's important that the book content be available on handheld reading devices. So one of the last slide to talk about is we asked libraries how likely are they to use this to use patron-driven acquisition in the future, and everyone said they were very likely to use it, likely to use it. I know at Wellesley we're expanding it next year. We'll be doing a lot more. We'll be spending more of our Monographs acquisitions budget on the patron acquisition program. And I just really want to get the message to you that if your books are not available through these aggregators, and I have to give a special plug to the aggregator that we use so that we can get access to your books, eBook Library, that if your content is not available through these aggregators, you're missing this whole revenue stream. And I know in the sciences that as I will be shifting more of my science collections Monographs budget into the patron-driven acquisitions, which means I will have less money to spend on your books if they're not in there. So we really hope that you'll get your content into the aggregators so that your books will continue to be purchased by our patrons as they're needed. So that's all I have, and we're going to take questions at the end.